Hi everyone. So today we're going to continue talking about free jazz of the early 60s. And we're going to come back now to John Coltrane. We talked about John Coltrane for a while in the hard bop era. But now John Coltrane's starting to branch out a little bit. I think one of the watershed things that happened to him in his career is he met a piano player by the name of McCoy Tyner and formed this quartet that just really, really launched into this new sort of new ground. They refer to it as the classic quartet with McCoy Tyner, Jimmy Garrison, and Elvin Jones. And one of the first things that he did with McCoy was take this tune from The Sound of Music called My Favorite Things and turned it into its own piece of art. And I'll show you a quick video clip of that. Okay, so I'm stopping it there just for time's sake, but you can tell, I mean, they're taking this sort of, you know, kind of middle of the road tune and making it into something much, much different, sort of this very, very creative, you know, platform for their improvisation as a group. Coltrane, you know, started also getting into his spirituality a little bit more, and one of his most famous records called A Love Supreme came out in 1964. Let's listen to a little bit of the beginning of that tune, or the beginning of that record. So there he's blending, you know, more of this sort of, freeness with some of that modality that we were talking about with the Miles Davis record, Kind of Blue. That tune's just sort of based on that bass line, and it goes where it goes. We're not missing some of the elements there like we are in other recordings. He did get a little bit more to the avant-garde side a little bit later on with a record called Ascension. Let's listen to a little bit of that one. So there, that's a larger group, very, very much like the Ornette Coleman free jazz record, playing, kind of throwing all those musical elements to the wind. There's not really a sense of time or, any sort of harmonic movement. There is a bit of a melody in there that, they're sort of playing off of each other. But once again, this is they would go on for a long time. This takes up the whole side of a record. Ascension. Unfortunately, Coltrane then he passed away in 1967 at the age of 40, which was very, very disappointing to folks. There's actually a church dedicated to John Coltrane in San Francisco. Our next superhero here we heard from early in the class, Mr. Wayne Shorter, it's probably not the greatest thing to associate Wayne with the free jazz movement, but I think his style of composition really opened up the music into these other sort of venues. And, his work with the Miles Davis Quintet in the 60s, which they call the Second Great Quintet, the first one being the one with John Coltrane, they definitely were exploring these sort of free spaces. I think I mentioned before in the Hard Bop video that when he joined Art Blakey's Jazz Messengers, it really kind of changed the direction of that group. That group became quite a bit more in a more contemporary sort of direction. So Wayne's catalog of composition goes really, really deep, but I'm going to play a tune that's going to be on your listening test from that Second Great Quintet. That sort of embraces this more sort of freestyle. This is a tune called Mescalero. To stop it there, it's just so beautiful, but you could tell that group just had this incredible interplay. And that tune, it wasn't really free at all. It was actually a composed piece with some harmony in it and rhythm. But the solos tend to be, the approach to it tends to be much, much more free. Shorter actually wrote a lot of tunes for that group, had quite a few LPs as a leader, and became very, very influential in the fusion era, which we're going to talk about next. He helped form this group called Weather Report, which had a bunch of folks who played with Miles over the years. And up till recently, he's been playing with this great quartet with Danilo Perez, John Patitucci, and Brian Blade. He's probably considered the greatest living jazz improviser and composer. Unfortunately, he's also having some health issues. He's getting up there. Anyway, our next superhero we're going to talk about, we already heard from a little bit in our Hard Bop video. He was playing in the Mingus video that I had in that video lecture. Notice in this picture here, Eric Dolphy, he's playing a bass clarinet. He actually got to be pretty famous for playing that instrument besides alto saxophone and flute. Kind of played a bunch of different woodwinds. Played with Chico Hamilton. We heard Chico Hamilton before with the Jerry Mulligan quartet. And really became, you know, one of Charles Mingus's right-hand men, you know, as you probably saw in that video. Did some playing with John Coltrane. Unfortunately, you know, another person who died early, his death was fairly controversial, actually. He was at a festival in Europe, and he collapsed on stage, and the people there thought it was due to drugs. As it turns out, he had maybe some sort of diabetic condition that he really, if they would have rushed him to the hospital, he may have lived, but, you know, it was prejudice. He did do one solo record, which is considered a classic. It's called Out to Lunch. And so I'm going to go ahead and play a cutoff of that called Straight Up and Down, just to kind of get an idea of his compositional style. Very angular melody there, repeated over and over, and then the solo section's a little more free sounding. Dolphy was considered a genius, especially of this free music. You know, his playing was very, very unusual, but you know, very, very musical, very, very musical and unusual at the same time. Albert Eiler, also another favorite of mine from the era. Another one of those folks, kind of like Ornette Coleman, who, you know, played in rhythm and blues bands and blues bands, actually met Stanley Turrentine, who became, you know, more of sort of a rhythm and blues player later. Just had this sort of, you know, folksy, bluesy sound. I'm going to let the sound speak for itself. This is a tune called Ghosts, off of his sort of classical record called Spiritual Unity. Let's check this out. Once again, I'm going to stop it right there for time's sake. Please listen to these all the way through on your own time. Definitely very emotional music. Eiler is very famous for his appearance at John Coltrane's funeral, where he played and he evidently screamed because he was so, you know, just touched and disappointed that, you know, Coltrane had passed away. He was definitely a hero of his. Later in life, he wanted to kind of move into a more of a rock direction, but was a sad person and ended up committing suicide. Another group coming up through this sort of free jazz era that really had a long history was this group called the Art Ensemble of Chicago. I associate them, and actually they were probably the primary group at the core of this group called the Association for the Advancement of Creative Musicians. Basically, this was a bunch of folks who got together and decided, you know, we need to figure out ways that we can sustain ourselves creatively, you know, mostly trying to figure out how we can, you know, financially do this. And so they pooled their resources and, you know, found grants and did, you know, fundraising and basically kept their music going and actually made it into a profession, you know, and, you know, made it something that was very, very artistic. So I'm going to go ahead and leave you with a little bit of video from the Art Ensemble of Chicago, a very, very unusual group with founding members Roscoe Mitchell, Lester Bowie, and others. They did over 40 LPs, and as you're going to see on the video, they were very much into this sort of not only the music, but performance art. They like to wear costumes and makeup. So I hope you enjoy a little bit of Art Ensemble Chicago. Thank you.